Next topic which we are going to discuss is India's ranking in Global Hunger Index, and related to this topic there was a comprehensive nutrition survey which has come. So I have linked these two topics into one topic, nutrition and challenges to nutrition. So recently Global Hunger Index was out and India's rank was 102 out of 117 countries. So what is this Global Hunger Index and how this index is made? We'll try to understand this and why India's rank is one of the poorest among all the developing countries. So this Global Hunger Index is an index which tracks hunger throughout the world. This index is basically made of four parameters. These are undernourishment, second stunting, third wasting, and fourth under 5 child mortality. These are the four parameters on which this Global Hunger Index is calculated. India's score was around 30, which was extreme hunger, which was severe condition. Severe hunger is there in India. And if you see India's rank compared to all the neighboring countries, be it Sri Lanka, be it Pakistan, be it Nepal, be it Bangladesh, all are doing better than India. So why India, although economically India is doing far better than these countries, but when we come to hunger, India is not doing as good as them. What are the reasons behind this? What are the reasons behind India's poor rank in hunger? Let us try to understand. So we will see that the reasons can be categorized into food and non-food reasons. The first reason is what? Obvious reason is what? People are not taking sufficient food. So people are not taking sufficient calories. So the hunger is there. And why people are not able to take sufficient food? Because of widespread poverty in India. India still has one of the largest population of poor people. India has one of the largest poor population. So the obvious reason is what? Lack of food intake, lack of sufficient food intake. And the basic reason behind this is what? Poverty and unemployment. Poverty and unemployment in India. But if we try to understand, the reason, the main reason is not this, but the main reason is non-food reasons. Non-food reason is women, position of women in India. So we'll see that most of the marriages in India are child marriage. Then the position of women in India is not up to the secondary treatment. So if you see, because of the child marriage, the children which are born to girls who are not adult, they are like 16-17, they are giving birth to children. So their child birth is low weight birth. Because of that, these children are prone to what? Malnourishment. They are prone to hunger. Because these girls are giving birth to children at a very young age, when the body is not ready to give birth. So child marriage is very prevalent in India, particularly states like Rajasthan and this northern states. Very high child marriage rate. Second is the secondary position of India, a woman in India. See, women still in India, because of the patriarchal society, they are not treated equally, they are not given sufficient food. Women in any Indian household eats at the end. So proper nutrition is not given to women, and because of that the child which is born is also suffering from this nutrition, and this vicious cycle of hunger goes on. The third is lack of clean drinking water. Lack of clean drinking water. See, lack of clean drinking water also leads to what? Hunger. Why? Because whatever they will eat, and they are not able to assimilate in their body because of this dirty water which they are taking, diarrhea, dysentery, various kinds of ailments they suffer from, and the proper nutrition does not goes to their body. Although they are taking sufficient food, but the food is not getting assimilated into the body because of lack of clean drinking water. Recently, Government of India has come out with a plan to provide piped clean drinking water to every household. This means what? Still we are far away from clean drinking water. And last but not the least is sanitation. The level of sanitation in India is also not up to the mark. That's why we had a mission called, still we are running, is Swachh Bharat Mission. Swachh Bharat Mission. Lack of sanitation also leads to hunger, because the child or the adult gets ill very soon because of this lack of sanitation. Open defecation, all these reasons are responsible for hunger. So hunger reasons you can divide in two reasons. One is the food component, other is the non-food component. In non-food component, you can also talk about this governance. See, a lot of corruption in PDS, in midday meal, a lot of corruption. So although we have a very elaborate arrangement, one of the largest food network, food distribution network in the world, but because of lack of accountability, because of lack of transparency, because of high leakages in this system, people do not get their entitlements and they suffer from hunger. So another reason, one more reason you can talk about is food habits. See, many times food habits are not good. They don't know what is the right nutrition for them. Further, because of working women, particularly in the rural areas, breastfeeding is not there. So these are the reasons for hunger and for poor rank of India. Although India is doing economically, it is doing good, better, but global hunger index, India's rank is 102 out of 117 countries, which is very bad. The reasons are this. Second news which was there related to nutrition was comprehensive nutrition survey. So what this comprehensive nutrition survey talks about? This comprehensive nutrition survey talks about few of the things related to nutrition. First, what? India is going through nutrition transition. Discuss this comprehensive nutrition survey. Comprehensive nutrition survey. So what this survey has talked about? The survey has talked about that India is going through nutrition transition. What is this nutrition transition? The nutrition transition is a state where a portion of population is suffering from undernourishment. At the same time, another section of the population is suffering from obesity or overnourishment. This is a nutrition transition. If you see in the developed world, generally the problem is obesity, overnourishment. But in developing world, particularly India, the problem is twofold: undernourishment and obesity. Undernourishment because we have already discussed why there is a hunger. Hunger is about food factors, non-food factors we have already discussed. And why there is obesity? Obesity, there are various reasons. Because of the lifestyle, because of the food habits. See, lifestyles today we are having what? Sedentary lifestyle. We do not exercise more. Most of the work is what? Sitting and doing. So because of that, we are suffering from obesity and food habits. Today we are going for packaged foods, processed foods, We are not going for natural foods. Because of that also, problem of obesity is increasing. And this obesity problem is also linked to another health crisis which India is undergoing. What is that health crisis? Non-communicable disease, NCD, non-communicable disease. Obesity is linked to multiple health ailments like blood pressure, like heart failures. Heart failure is becoming one of the main reason of unnatural death in these days. So NCD, obesity. And why there is obesity? Because of food habits, because of lifestyle. So these are the reasons, these are the things which have been brought out by the comprehensive nutrition survey. One more interesting fact which was highlighted by this survey was generally women who are educated, their family do not have nutrition problem. So women empowerment, women educational empowerment is linked directly to nutrition. How? Let us see. When women are educated, they can make good food choices. She knows, okay, which food is good. When women are educated, they know the importance of breastfeeding. So because of women education, they can make some choices related to food. When women are educated, child marriages are delayed. When women are educated, child marriages are delayed. So because of that, generally educated women do not suffer from anemia. So this survey has also highlighted that women education can also play a significant role in nutrition. In nutrition. So can you name few schemes which government of India is running for the nutrition? Here you can mention about ICDS, Integrated Child Development Scheme. You can talk about Midday Meal Scheme. You can talk about National Nutrition Strategy. We can talk about National Nutrition Mission. All this you can talk about. We must be knowing this, that Poshan Abhiyan, Poshan Abhiyan, National Nutrition Mission, Poshan Abhiyan has been started by India few years back. It is a comprehensive scheme on nutrition. It's a comprehensive scheme on nutrition. Whenever you get a question on nutrition, whenever you get a question on health related to food, always segregate that topic into food related and non-food related, because there are social determinants of hunger also. There are social determinants of malnourishment also. And what are these social determinants? Women empowerment, women education, discrimination against scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. If you see, hunger among tribals are higher than hunger among general population. Hunger among scheduled tribes are more than hunger among general population, because these communities, sometimes in rural areas, they are socially excluded from the society. So this you can write out. Now the last topic which I have selected from GS3 is the livestock survey. Recently 20th livestock survey has come. I will not talk about the factual aspect. I'll talk about what can come from the mains perspective. See, in economy GS3, there is a topic called economics of animal rearing. There is a topic called economics of animal rearing. So can we critically examine this livestock survey from economics of animal rearing? So what does this survey talks about? The survey talks about what? That total livestock has increased. Okay, very good. Total livestock has increased, very good. Second, this survey points out that the increase in female population in the livestock is more than male population. Second, this survey talks about female population of livestock. The rise is comparatively higher than the male. Third, it talks about what? That this exotic and foreign breed, the growth is bigger than the indigenous breed. So these are the some of the highlights of the survey. Now we will try to examine the economics of animal rearing from this survey. See, we all know in cattle, which is the productive cattle? Obviously the female. Female cattle is productive cattle. Suppose you take cow, so cow gives milk, it is productive. So if you see the male cattle, it was basically used for what? The manual labor, for a bullock cart or for agricultural fields. But today what we are trying, we are replacing this bullock cart with what? Motorized tractors and then other vehicles, and the plowing is done through tractors. So increased mechanization is there. So because of increased mechanization of Indian agriculture, male cattle are not required. Male cattle are not required. So how can you explain this economics of animal rearing? Okay, because female are required, because female are productive. Now male are not that productive because we have mechanization, we have mechanized transport, we have mechanized plowing, mechanized all this. So we males are not required. So if you see, there is dip in the male population and there is a rise in the female population, productive population has risen. Second, what explains this jump in exotic and foreign breed cattle? We must be knowing that the biggest challenge in livestock industry in India is what? Poor yield. The yield of indigenous breed of cattle is less. But this yield of this foreign bred exotic cattle is more. So this also explains economics of animal rearing or not. Because the yield is high, although government has a scheme called Rashtriya Gokul Mission. Rashtriya Gokul Mission, where government is trying to increase the indigenous breed. However, the exotic breeds are increasing more in comparison to indigenous breed. Why? Because of ill economics of animal rearing. Farmer is only interested in what? More production, more profit. So he thinks that this exotic breed will give more milk. So he is going for exotic breed rather than indigenous breed. Although government's scheme is to try to increase this indigenous breed. So these are the some of the things which I wanted to highlight, because this factual aspects is there in the newspaper, but this analytical aspect is not there. Let me briefly tell you about this livestock. What is the importance of this livestock? See, this livestock basically comprises 25% of agri GDP. Livestock comprises 25% of agri GDP. Livestock is a security of income for the farmers. See, today in the era of climate change, sometimes crops are failing because of sudden precipitation, sudden rainfall, sudden thunderstorm, sudden hailstorm. But in such circumstances, if the farmer has an alternate source of income, then the security of income of farmers can be protected. Third, if you see, livestock is generally reared by small and marginal farmers. Small and marginal farmers. So it is also important for what? Inclusive growth. This is a topic in your GS3. Inclusive growth. Inclusive growth is a growth which is broad-based growth, which all the segments of the society, particularly the vulnerable section of the society, they are included in the growth process. So generally, if you see this livestock, who owns more livestock? Generally poor, marginal, small farmers. Generally women household, they go for this livestock. Women. So women empowerment also, this livestock is very important for women empowerment. So this is the importance of livestock. And what are the challenges of livestock? What are the challenges of livestock? Can you talk about some challenges? So what are the challenges? First challenge is what? Breed. Because Indian breeds yield is poor. Yield is poor. So there is a need to cross breed, exotic breed, foreign breed, so that the yield is more. Second, diseases. Recently our honorable Prime Minister, they have launched what? One new scheme where they are checking foot and mouth disease in cattle. Their new scheme they have started. So disease, generally cattle, they suffer from foot and mouth disease. This disease control. Third is the infrastructure. See, cold chains, all is still lacking. Fourth, veterinary science. So livestock also has various challenges, and these challenges has to be tackled in order to grow livestock. And because of that, government has come out with National Livestock Mission. National Livestock Mission and National Livestock Policy 2013. This mission is 2014. So you can talk about these things. Now let me discuss one last topic from ethics, GS4. So we have tackled topic from GS2, then GS3, and lastly we will take topic from GS4. See, recently one of the leading company in Indian IT sector has faced some problems. What has happened? One group, ethical employee group of that company, has blown whistle about some wrongdoing by the CEO and CFO of the company. In this context, let us try to examine what is whistleblowing. What is whistleblowing? And what are the ethical issues related to whistleblowing? So recently what has happened? A group called Ethical Employees in Infosys has blew the whistle that the CEO and CFO are doing some corrupt practices in the company. So this is called whistleblowing. Whistleblowing is basically an act in which the employee working in the organization will highlight some corrupt activity going on inside the company. This is called whistleblowing. And what is the challenge in whistleblowing? What are the ethical aspects? So ethical aspect is, see, if you blow the whistle, and if suppose company is doing something wrong and you blow the whistle, so what will happen? The company's reputation will get hurt. You know, in one day Infosys lost 54,000 crore in market capitalization. Stock prices crashed. In one day 54,000 crore was lost in one day. So what happens when you blow the whistle? There is an ethical dilemma. What is loyalty towards the company? Because the company reputation will get hurt. And conscience of the worker. Because the conscience, he might be saying, okay, wrong is going on, I have to speak against this wrong. So this ethical dilemma comes. If you see this last year UPSC, they has asked question, Julian Assange, he also blew the whistle against the mass surveillance by the America. So he also blew the whistle. WikiLeaks, all this. So whistleblowing, is whistleblowing good? Or sometimes whistleblowing is also used to malign the reputation of the company sometimes. So in every company they have some guidelines for whistleblowing. You can blow whistle when these situation. And in every company some protection is provided to the whistleblower. Even in India we have a Whistleblower Protection Act. If government employees find some corrupt activities going on in their department, they can blow the whistle, they can report to the CVC under this whistleblowing provision. So, whistleblowing, what you have to highlight? You have to highlight this conscience, honesty. These are the values. Courage, moral courage is required to blow the whistle. So, these are the things. So, by this we end this class. Thank you.